My name is Gerard Batten. I'm a member of the European Parliament for London for the UK Independence Party. And we're here today outside the Grove Hotel where they're having the Bilderberg meeting because I'm one of those many people from many different political points of view who are asking the question, what are these people meeting for? I think this year is very significant because it's the first year in 59 years that we've actually got members of the mainstream press and media turning up to actually interview people like me and Alex Jones, who's here and filming me today, and asking what's going on. That's a major breakthrough. And I think that the reason that people are very upset about this is because they don't know what the conclusions are of these meetings. Now, they say they don't have any conclusions, but are we really supposed to believe that 130, 140 people of the most powerful, richest, influential people in the world give up their time, fly across the world to come here, and it doesn't have a significance? I don't believe that for a minute. If it isn't significant, why would they come? If it is significant, what does it all mean? And I think the reason that a party like mine, the UK Independence Party, is soaring ahead in the polls and getting votes is because people now feel that politics is something that's done to them and not something that's done for them. And this is the heart of the malaise. Absolutely. People feel that it doesn't matter what they think, it doesn't matter what they believe, they're going to have these policies that they don't want thrust down their throat anyway. And this is where my party's different, whether you agree with us or not. A lot of people feel that we're sincere and we actually stand for certain things, and that's why they're voting for us.
I heard you speaking with the London Telegraph just a few minutes ago, and you've obviously done your research because it's been declassified. The CIA funded the creation of the European Union. UKIP's the fastest growing party, obviously, now in the UK in the last elections, because you guys talk about how you're losing your sovereignty and how you've got EU license plates and 80% of your laws or so are EU and you don't get a vote on it. But again, it's a corporate group that took over America, created the UN, created all this. It's not even really America, but it was the CIA, kind of this corporate body that's anti-free market, kind of monopoly men, that did set up the EU to get rid of the sovereignty of Europe. I mean, if Hitler would have come up with a corporate plan to take over, we'd all be...
He did. Because, in actual fact, in 1942, the German bank, German central bank, under Dr. Walter Funk, along with leading industrialists, said, how are we going to run the economy of Europe after we've won the war? Because at that time...
You know your stuff. The EU is a Nazi plan.
Europäische Wirtschaftsgemeinschaft, the European Economic Community, that's what they called it. And it had a common agricultural policy, a common this policy, a common that policy. And I haven't done enough research on this, but I'll be willing to bet that some of the civil servants that drew that plan up actually found jobs 10 or 15 years
Prince Bernhard was an SS officer, and he was the founder.
And Queen Bernhard of the Netherlands is here. Oh, the Queen of the Netherlands is here.
And her son is about to be king.
Yep, and she comes to every one of these
meetings. Okay, so specifically, though, talk about the 60s and that vote and the CIA funding the euro.
Well, 1975 is the last time that we had a referendum in this country, and it wasn't about joining the EU because Ted Heath had already taken us in with no mandate, no democratic mandate to do it.
But under a trade deal, just like in the US, we're under free trade.
That's what they told us, but everybody who knew anything about it knew that wasn't the case anyway. But anyway, we got in, Harold Wilson won an election saying, I'll give you a referendum on the EU, and it was about whether we should accept his renegotiated terms, stay in or get out. And we don't know the exact figures, but the CIA put money into the Yes campaign, the BBC had meetings every day to make sure that there was a Yes vote delivered, major organs of the press were involved in that. So the No vote were totally outspent and outclassed in terms of a campaign.
So is this not a corporate takeover via EU government?
Well, that was the CIA, so presumably they get their money from the government. So I see this as an instrument of American foreign policy at the time, because as Henry Kissinger said, who do I talk to when I want to ring Europe? He doesn't want to ring 20-odd individual nation states and have to worry about dealing with them. He wants to deal with one centralized authority, a United States of Europe. So I see this as your corporate idea may well be very valid.
Well, sure, it's Bilderberg that gives the orders in the U.S., though. It's the main contingent is Americans and Brits and then some EU. We've gotten their minutes. We've gotten their documents. They say what you just said. Carl Quigley, who was allowed into their minutes in the 60s, wrote Tragedy and Hope, and he said, autocratic thing run by central bankers into freedom, controlling both major parties in countries, Democrat, Republican, Labor, Tory, creating the illusion of choice. The fact that UKIP's getting so popular, speaking out against the New World Order, they criticize you guys then, but it only makes you more popular. Does that signify that people are awakening and people like Nigel Farage and yourself are kind of the Ron Pauls of Europe?
Well, I don't claim any great status myself. Basically, what we're doing, I think, is asking the questions and trying to come up with some answers. And I think more and more people are aware that politics is not being run for their benefit. And, you know, you talk about, people talk about this being a capitalist system. This isn't capitalism. Capitalism is supposed to be fair and open with a free market, and that's not what you're getting now in the modern world, where things are stitched up corporately, as you rightly point out. So it isn't a crisis of capitalism, it's a crisis of democratic government and a fair economic system.
Sure. Last question, this huge lobbying scandal, members of parliament resigning and things, isn't this the big lobbying scandal right here? They've gotten in trouble for criminal lobbying before, back in the 70s with the Lockheed Martin scandal and Prince Bernhard.
Well, I think that the George Osborne, who's here, who's a minister of the government, as indeed Kenny Clark, may well be in breach of the ministerial rules, because that lays down that they're supposed to be open about who they're talking to, and particularly with members of the press, they're supposed to log every meeting, and you've got people here who own vast swathes of the media in one way or another, so I think there may well be some questions asked, but I wouldn't hold out much hope of actually anything being done about it.
Is UKIP going to call for criminal investigations of this?
Well, I think what we'll do, when I get back to my office, I'm going to be looking at the rules in detail and writing to David Cameron and raising the issues that I think are relevant. So we'll do our best. But I've written many letters, Alex. A lot of them get ignored and don't often actually result in much action.
But big things have small beginnings.
Yeah.
If you could speak for 1 minute to the Bilderberg attendees, the royalty, the people, the corporate barons, the government regulators, the EU bureaucrats that are arriving with people that they regulate, if you could say you know, 1 minute of words to them, you know, as a member of the European Union Parliament, what would you say to them?
I would say, if you are really here to talk about things in the public interest, which is what they maintain, why do you think you can achieve it in secrecy? Why wouldn't you achieve more by being public? Okay, you could have a discussion about what the problems are and the solutions in private, but any decisions that you arrive at, any policy recommendations should be in public, because you need to take the public with you. And obviously they're not doing that because the public wouldn't want to go on the trip that they've got planned for them. But I'd ask them to do that. If it's genuine, be open and honest about it. Because what people feel now is that, as I said earlier, politics is not something that's done for them, it's done to them.
You had a great point, though, about how if they don't have any power, why would they be traveling from all over the world in great expense and secrecy and paying for part of the millions of pounds being spent here if this didn't have any power? And we have so many of their minutes where they set up the euro. They brag. They created the brain trust in 54 with the trade agreements, Treaty of Rome, Treaty of London, and then later the votes to hoodwink people into this undemocratic system where the EU bureaucrats are above the law.
Well, exactly. I mean, Alex, even as prominent and important as person as you are, I'm sure you'd find it difficult to get 10 minutes in George Osborne's diary.
Absolutely.
But he can come here and spend 2 or 3 days away from his desk, away from his onerous responsibilities, and spend it. He wouldn't do that unless it was important, and neither would any of these other people. So it must be very important or they wouldn't do it. I don't believe it's just a talking shop. These people don't have time to waste. They will only do it if it's significant and there's a real reason for doing it.
This is the last question. I know you've got to go. It's so amazing to talk to a member of the EU Parliament who's exposing it from the inside. Looking at this whole event, every time the BBC or the London Telegraph or any of them come up and talk to me or they talk to you, they say, are you a conspiracy theorist? For a long time, they said this didn't even exist. Now we force them to report it, and then we're somehow bad that we're wanting to know what policy is being made in there by this shadowy group, and we have WikiLeaks documents from Bilderberg. They've confirmed are real, where Kissinger says, illegal we do immediately, unconstitutional takes longer. I mean, this is a guy known for war crimes.
Yeah. I'm sorry, I forgot what your question was there.
I'm sorry. What do you say about them using that throwaway term of conspiracy theorist?
Well, I say, what's the definition of a conspiracy? It's two or more people meeting in secret to achieve an end, which might be illegal or illegal. So in the strict use of the word, it is a conspiracy, because we don't know what they're talking about. Unless they have no objective at all, and it's just a friendly chat over a cup of tea, which none of us believe. And I think the bigger conspiracy, in inverted commas, has been the fact that the media haven't spoken about this for 59 years and have allowed it to go on without any reporting. And I think that's the real conspiracy. And now that, let's hopefully that's come to an end, and the media are actually going to look at what.
Wow! If it has no power, why was the media able to be shut up for so long?
Well, they weren't shut up. Look who owns the media. The media is owned by powerful people, and those same powerful people go to meetings like this. So, you know, in Britain, I know it's like in America, it's probably very similar. You've got a few powerful people that own newspapers or television stations, and of course, they ultimately decide what's reported and what's not.
Sir, thank you so much. How do we visit the UKIP website?
www.ukip.org. or you can look at my website, which is www.gerardbattonmep.co.uk.
I want to thank you for coming out to this, sir. Thank you so much. And we've got members of the German Bundestag going public saying they've attended and it's evil. We've got members of the British Parliament that are coming out saying they attended and that it should be open. And now Bilderberg is really feeling the heat from our sources, including the BBC guy. He went in there to have lunch with him. He told us that on the phone. I came out, was interviewed by him. He admitted they're feeling incredible heat and may even have a press conference. So it is unprecedented the amount of heat they're feeling. They don't like it.
It's quite hot out here as well.
Absolutely. Again, thank you, sir.
You're welcome.
All right, folks, great job. Let's continue. It really starts to kick off now. Infowars.com. Yes, sir.
Nice to see you.
Great. Thank you for the presentation.
I'm here until Monday. I'm flying out Monday morning.